Welcome to part two of What Can Hallelujah Teach Us About Songwriting? In part one, I discussed the song's first verse and chorus, and focused on illuminating the universal songwriting techniques of Leonard Cohen's masterpiece. In part two, I'll focus on the song's second verse and discuss its defining characteristics: image, allusion, and alliteration. Let's take a listen to the first verse.
Your faith was strong, but you needed proof. You saw her bathing on the roof, her beauty and the moonlight overthrew you. She tied you to a kitchen chair, she broke your throne and she cut your hair, and from your lips she drew the
The images in this verse are concise and clear. I instantly see in my mind's eye a woman bathing on a roof in the moonlight. It's an unfamiliar yet instantly imaginable scene full of beauty and mystery. This is what great songwriters do. They begin with ordinary, individual components like the moonlight, a woman, a rooftop, and proceed to combine them together in extraordinary ways. Lyrics benefit from details that provide context, move the narrative forward, and draw the listener inside the framework of the song. Cohen includes enough detail for the listener to imagine the scene, but not so much detail that the scene can only be pictured in one way. We're given creative license to fill in the remaining particulars as we please. Where's the rooftop? What time of night is it? What does the woman look like? No one's answers are likely to align perfectly, but we're all given the same simple, powerful visual scene: a woman on a rooftop in the moonlight. Cohen does much the same sketchwork in the following line when he writes, "She tied you to a kitchen chair." That's the lyric in its official printed form. Now, it's worth noting that on the album, Cohen certainly seems to sing "She tied you to her kitchen chair" instead of "a kitchen chair," but this disparity doesn't really change our analysis, so let's continue. He provides enough detail to provoke the imagination, but is careful not to oversaturate the scene. If he had just said, "She tied you to a chair," the line would be too sparse, not detailed enough. If he had said, "She tied you to the old maple kitchen chair with yellow upholstery and capriole legs," well, that's overkill. A single descriptor for the chair strikes a great balance, and also sets the scene. By saying kitchen chair, each listener's mind is free to be drawn to a kitchen chair they've seen before, perhaps a chair resembling one from their childhood or current home. In this way, the detail can be individualized, allowing for each listener to connect in his or her own way. But don't think Cohen chose the word kitchen at random. No, the word serves both a structural and sonic purpose. The modifier of the word chair needed to be a two-syllable word in order to make the line's syllable count consistent with the corresponding fourth line of the previous verse, which has eight syllables. It goes like this: the fourth, the fifth. This subtle alignment of structure really helps tie the verses together. Furthermore, the word kitchen carries sonic weight. Kitchen chair is alliterative. Kitchen. Chair. We have the ch sound in both words. Now we can appreciate the full functionality of the word kitchen here. It lends detail to the line, it ensures structural similarity across verses, and it sets up alliteration with the next word. The quotidian nature of a kitchen chair is then contrasted with the ornate, ceremonial, powerful connotations of a throne in the next phrase, "She broke your throne." The word throne also serves a sonic purpose with its connection to the word overthrew in the second line, overthrew throne. And the word overthrew was of course chosen because of its alignment with the last word of this verse, hallelujah. Overthrew ya, hallelujah, a stunning rhyme. Every word has been chosen purposefully. She broke your throne and she cut your hair. The roles have been reversed. Previously, the woman was vulnerable, naked on the rooftop. Now it's the man who's vulnerable. He's tied up with a blade near his head. His throne, a symbol of power, has been broken. He's now at the complete mercy of the woman. And what does she do? She has him utter the word hallelujah, this word of praise and worship. Does he do it willingly or at her behest, commanded to do whatever she says due to his compromised position? Is the scene sensual, violent, both, neither? Again, we're given enough detail to excite the imagination without forcing it to a particular conclusion. Okay, so I've just analyzed the images and action of this verse in isolation. That is to say, without taking into account the references and allusions Cohen makes in these lines to the Hebrew Bible. As we can see, this verse is amazingly powerful by itself. To be moved by the verse, it's not necessary to understand the allusions contained within it. The principle of songwriting that can be stated here is that references and allusions can be used effectively as long as their comprehension is not a prerequisite to, or a distraction from, the appreciation of at least one meaning of the lyric. A reference is best used when it adds meaning without diminishing the lyric's immediacy, and a reference should avoid rendering the lyric unintelligible to the listener. So then, what are the allusions in this verse? The images of this verse conflate two biblical stories, the story of Bathsheba and King David, yes, the same David who played the secret chord that pleased the Lord, and the story of Samson and Delilah. In the second book of Samuel, chapter 11, it says, quote, "And it came to pass in an evening tide that David arose from off his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman washing herself, and the woman was very beautiful to look upon." End quote. That's right. Leonard Cohen's stunning image in this first verse is in fact a direct reference to a scene from the Bible, and not just a scene but an entire story. This is what happens after David sees the woman bathing on the roof. He finds out that the woman is named Bathsheba. He sends for her and she comes to the palace. He then lies with her and she becomes with child, as they say. Soon after, King David sends for her husband and purposefully has him sent into battle on the front lines where he's killed. David then takes Bathsheba as his wife, and she gives birth to a son. This series of events displeases the Lord of the Old Testament because he had given David everything, yet David wanted more, and took from men who had next to nothing. So the Lord declares that the firstborn son of David and Bathsheba will die, which he does 7 days later. One has to admire the subtle ways in which Cohen altered this biblical scene. In the original, at least as it comes to us in translation, it says, "From the roof, he saw a woman washing herself." It's clear that David is on the roof, but the use of "from" makes it seem like the woman is down below. She can't see him, but he can see her. In Cohen's verse, however, you see her bathing on the roof. This is a subtle but seismic change in perspective. Furthermore, in light of this biblical story, the "and" in the line, "her beauty and the moonlight overthrew ya," becomes charged with meaning. Moonlight isn't mentioned in the biblical version. David is overthrown by Bathsheba's beauty alone. But interestingly, in the song, the woman's beauty alone isn't enough to seduce the observer. The moonlight is a key factor. This is significant because it hints at an otherworldly cause that helps provoke the events that follow. Unlike the biblical story, where God holds David solely accountable for his actions, Cohen motions to the heavenly bodies and asks, "Who's in charge of those?" This biblical story and Cohen's verse follow the same arc, a man in power subsequently humbled. But David, in spite of everything, would go on to compose hallelujah hymns to the same Lord who struck down his child. In the same vein, our narrator, in spite of past defeats, is singing hallelujah too, more than likely in praise of this godlike lover of his whose scorn he's felt. The second story alluded to in this verse is found in the book of Judges. Samson, an Israelite leader, has superhuman strength and he loves a woman named Delilah. Delilah is paid by Samson's enemies, the Philistines, to find out Samson's source of strength. At one point, Delilah takes ropes and ties Samson up, testing his strength. He easily breaks the ropes, but eventually Samson succumbs to Delilah's constant questioning and tells her that if his hair were to be cut, all his strength would vanish. Delilah then has his hair cut when he's asleep, and Samson is taken prisoner by the Philistines. Both biblical stories deal with the same themes of love, betrayal, and a fall from grace. The allusions, though they're not necessary in order for Cohen's powerful verse to be understood on one level, nevertheless serve as subtext to expand its meaning and power. All songs deal with the same handful of universal themes. What makes some lyrics more powerful than others is not their thematic novelty, but rather their details and carefully constructed images, along with their poetic structure and the manner in which the lyrics are conveyed. Finally, I would like to discuss the use of pronouns in this verse. You saw her bathing on the roof. Her beauty overthrew you. She tied you to a kitchen chair. Who is the you in this verse? In part one, I speculated that the you in this song's first verse refers to a past or current lover of the narrator. This was put forth as an alternative explanation to the one Eric Weinstein suggested on Lex Friedman's podcast, in which he proposed that the you was a direct address to the listener. So, is the you in this moonlight verse referring to the lover or to the listener? Well, primarily, neither, in my opinion. I believe the you in this verse is distinct from the you of the first verse. Here, the you is self-referential. The narrator is addressing himself in the second person. Not only that, but the she in this verse is the you of the first verse. You don't really care for music, do you? This interpretation crystallizes the relationship between the narrator and the woman and avoids any bitterness toward the audience. The line, "Your faith was strong, but you needed proof," is derisive if it points outward toward the listener. However, if it's meant for the narrator himself, it becomes reflective and self-deprecating, which is consistent with Leonard Cohen's writing style throughout his career. The you here is used in the same vein as when we mutter things to ourselves like, "You had it all, but you just had to go and mess it up, didn't you?" Or, "Your faith was strong, but you just needed proof, didn't you?" The statements, "My faith is strong," and "I must prove that my faith is justified by the truth," are discordant. Faith exists in the absence of proof. And this dichotomy between faith and proof lends the line a certain humor. I find that many of Cohen's songs are imbued with subtle jokes that make me smile. The subjects he tackles are serious, but he nearly always finds room for a one-liner. Now, back to the pronouns. I'll concede that the you here also serves the linguistic purpose of appealing directly to the listener. Its use brings the listener directly into the scenes painted by these lines. In this sense, its effect is, "Hey, you, look at her bathing on the roof. Look at yourself being tied to the chair. Look at your hair being cut. Watch as you utter the word hallelujah." And of course, if we understand the allusions, the you can be addressing the figures of David and Samson as well, but these characters themselves are archetypes of the flawed hero in us all. So, who is the you, and who is the narrator? I believe that the narrator is the you in this verse, and the you is the David-like character in all of us. It's the part of us that experiences the thrills of victory and the agonies of defeat. It's the part of us that, above all, says yes to life, in spite of all the suffering. It's the part that sings hallelujah at both weddings and funerals. Okay, so that does it for part two of this hallelujah analysis. Looks like I've got one more to go. If you've enjoyed this, you can support me on Patreon, check out my own music, or even contact me for a songwriting class. Everything is in the links below and on my website, jakeshane.com. Thanks so much for tuning in, and until next time.